Welcome. Welcome, women of RIT, and welcome, women from the business community. I am so thrilled and so honored to be here with you today, and I am actually filled with gratitude to be able to share with you a topic that I am so very passionate about, gender intelligence, so that I have a way to be able to create understanding and knowledge around this topic. The discussion today is really what I call a discovery talk track. And the reason that I call it a discovery talk track is because we're just skimming across the top of this information in the next 45 minutes. And my goal for you is to be able to collect information, data, context, vernacular, principles, when you walk out of here so that you can continue the conversation outside the room. You formulate opinions and you collect opinions and you keep the conversation alive. That would be a win-win for me. For some of us in the room today, this conversation might be a little bit challenging. And for some of us, it might feel very comfortable, and you'll see yourself in some of the stories and data that we share. For those of you where it might be a little bit uncomfortable, I encourage you to think about it like putting on a tight pair of jeans or a tight shirt. Has anybody ever done that? And it actually find out that it stretches? Yeah. So it stretches. And in this conversation, like any context, the more that you visit it, the more that you explore it, the better it feels and the more that you get more comfortable with it. So if you don't find yourself in the data or you say, that's not me, think of the analogy that I just gave you. And the goal is so that we can all have a better conversation and that we can all engage in the conversation, even if you find it a little challenging. So before I get started, I want to share with you two stories. Real life stories, clients that I've worked with in other cities. And I want you to think about the theme that's running through these two stories. The first story is about an attorney. And she had a very successful practice, and she had, you know, her client base, and it was humming. And she found herself elected to being up in the partner ranks. And I met her right after she had had her first partner meeting. And she was in the minority in the room, the gender minority in the room. And she shared with me, she said, Samantha, she said, I felt like an imposter. I didn't belong there, and I was completely uncomfortable. And she shared with me that she did three things in that meeting to keep herself safe as being part of the minority in the room. She shrunk up her body space so that she wouldn't be seen or noticed. She didn't look anybody in the eyes to make eye contact. And she purposely kept her opinion to herself. Interesting. This woman had the capability and the competence and the recognition to be at the partner level of this firm, but that's how she chose to behave. The second story is about a construction worker. It's really about a safety officer who I had a conversation with right after this happened. And she shared with me that she was walking onto the construction site and she sees a very similar situation to this male construction worker climbing on a ladder. I see people shaking their head. Who's a safety manager in the room, right? Hello. And she walks by this gentleman and she realizes that two things are gonna happen. Well, maybe three if she's lucky. The ladder's gonna fall, life and death, or serious injury, right? And as she walks by, the construction worker catches her eye and he looks at her and he points her finger. And he says, you see nothing. You need to keep walking and don't open your mouth. She's the security officer. What choices does she make? The choice that she makes is she says, you know what, that's not good. You know, you need to fix that, not appropriate. And she keeps walking. So I ask you, what's the theme in these two stories?
Power and equity.
Thank you, Miranda. Power and equity. They both didn't feel that they were on an equal playing field, right? What else?
Well, there was a lack of courage and authenticity. Both deserved and earned the opportunity to say power and
You're so right. They chose to be silent. You are so right. What else?
Intimidation.
They were intimidated, right? There's what was said earlier, the lack of power differential that they perceived, right? And so they chose not to step in to what they knew they could handle and that they should be doing, right? Absolutely. So I wanted just to put those up there because I think it's going to be a running theme that we'll be able to pull through as we continue the content. So has anybody read the book by Simon Sinek? Yeah, a few people. My why. My why is because I believe in thinking differently. I believe that putting in the forefront for contemporary leadership and being able to help women understand what obstacles and blind spots stand in their way for this contemporary women's leadership and in the new era of the 21st century. I believe that all of the pieces are out there that speak to us, but not in a way that helps us understand what these blind spots are, what gets in front of us and creates these blind spots, in a way that I'm going to share with you today. These blind spots that get in front of us are what I call gender power differentials. Gender power differentials. And these gender power differentials keep us from performing as individuals and keep us from performing as leaders. Is there something I can do with this? Do I have it? Is that better? You think I should go up? Oh, all right. Let's try this. Thank you. Technology is not where I'm at. Okay, so gender power differentials. So I want to share with you kind of the basis for everything we're going to talk about today. And I did have the good fortune of being able to testify in front of Congress this past summer. And it was an amazing experience, and I am grateful for the opportunity to be able to do that and to help put forth information and data around what's holding women back and stepping into more senior roles in corporate America. One of the things that I thought was really, really important was not only just to provide the data and the information from all the research that I've done, but I wanted to go out to my network and I wanted to collect the voices of the women in my network who were high impact women and who could help me validate the information that I was putting out there. What an amazing experience that was. The women, the high impact women, you know, headstrong, heart strong, values driven, you know, CEOs, entrepreneurs, vice presidents, directors, etc. What the theme that they shared with me was, you know what, Samantha? They said, I get that as a woman, I'm responsible for work-life balance. I get that as a woman, I have to deal with re-entry into the workforce after childcare, or taking care of my children. And I also know and understand and accept that I'm responsible for elder care. I get all that. That I can deal with. But what I cannot deal with and what I do feel holds me back is what's called the uneven playing field that they all mentioned and referenced in some way, shape, or form. And when I continued to collect the data, it all lined up into four critical areas of how women felt the playing field was uneven for them. They first said unintended biases by men and women. And these unintended biases had a direct correlation to relationships. And it impacted the relationships negatively. It impacted how they built trust. The gender biases impacted how they communicated, the transparency in their communication. It impacted how they were promoted and advanced through the organizations. The second thing that they said was, you know what? I have a voice and I have an opinion, but I don't feel respected. And I don't feel heard. And that rang true for me when I heard that, because right about that time that I was testifying in Congress, President Obama's senior staff came out with an article, I think it was the New York Times or the New York Post, and it rang true to exactly what these women were saying. The story that was put out by President Obama's senior staff said that the women in the room sitting around the table with the president In order to be heard at the table, they had to play a little game with each other. So the game was, when any woman in the room speaks at this table, that we echo each other's voices and opinions, because if we don't, there's a high probability that a man will take my voice and my opinion and will take it for their own, and I will not get the credit. And so that became something that was a constant within the women in the room, and eventually the guys caught on. And they respected it. They understood finally what was happening, and they respected it. Has anybody ever had that happen to them? Raise your hand. Yeah, quite a bit, right? The third thing that they said was, I'm not working to my potential. I have more to give. I thought, what? I'm not working to my potential. I have more to give. And what they meant by that was, I'm not being given opportunities for advancement and to be included in higher level opportunities. It might be a key client, it might be a strategic conversation, it might be critical problem solving, it might be a career path. But I have more to give and I don't feel valued. And the last thing that they said was, I don't feel included and I don't think I fit in. So some of these women thought that I believe that some of them had a level of feeling included, and I think it's probably, you know, it could be any range, but I'm guessing 60 to 80%, but they didn't feel like they had both feet in the organization and that they were part of either the bigger picture of the organization or the team or the leadership team. They just felt like they were a little bit on the outside, and that inclusiveness, lack of inclusiveness, affected their ability to participate at a full level. Interesting, right? Interesting data. I share that data with you because it's a running theme through the rest of this. So the agenda for today is to continue talking about blind spots for high-achieving women and to talk about this uneven playing field that we've already referenced. We're going to talk about the twin towers of power, the twin tower of power and dominance. And we're going to talk about this gender intelligent concept, which is relatively new, but has been researched for the last 20 plus years. And then we're going to talk about the neuroscience that actually links back through the behaviors that differentiate men and women in leadership. So before we get started, I always find it mission critical to manage expectations in the room. This is a high-charged conversation that we're having, and it's really key that we don't get off track and get off the rails. So if I put some expectations out there, it'll make it clear as to the direction that we're trying to go into. It's critical to understand that men and women are alike. We're alike in our capabilities. We're equal. We're alike and we're equal, but we are not the same. We are not the same because we're not the same. Neuroscience has recently told us and proven to us through the data that there are 20% differential between the differences between men and women and how we're biologically designed. 20% differential, including our brains. So we're not alike, and that's a good thing, right? We'd be all men or we'd be all women, which is it? So this differential impacts us in very key ways. As we talk about gender equity, the definition for gender equity is, if you take the core definition, it's about equality in responsibility and equality in opportunity, right, that we have offered to us. But if you take the generalization of gender equality too far, you can make the leap that it has everything to do with gender sameness, that we're the same, just like we just mentioned. And we know that's not true now. Where before, I think it was back in before 1990, all of the pharmaceutical drugs were only tested on men because we were the same. We were the same. It wasn't until 1990 that they realized there were significant hormonal differences and design differences, that the drugs could interact very differently with women. As we talk about the gender gap refers to the differences in the labor force opportunities. And you know, those things are real, and we're not here to debate them. But when we talk about the gender gap, it also lends itself to thinking about equalizing the gender in corporate America. And when we equalize the genders, we don't want to equalize the numbers in theory. We want to balance. We want to create balance for respect in the workplace. That's what we're talking about. Because if you try to equalize the numbers, what you're really talking about is gender parity. Has anybody ever heard of gender parity before? Modern media is starting to write about gender parity and put it out there. And there's a global parity index. And the global parity index says that we have 170 years before we reach gender parity globally. I don't know about you, but I don't have 170 years to wait for that. And I don't want to know what I'm going to look like in 170 years. So the answer is to talk about gender intelligence and respect in the workplace, and how do we step into opportunities that create better outcomes for all of us. So as we talk about leadership, leadership is one of the first elements that creates a business case. One of the reasons that male CEOs and leaders in the C-suite are starting to become intrigued by this concept of gender intelligence is because of these two case studies. These two business cases, if you will. One is leadership, and the other one is ROI. So there is a business case around leadership. And the Fortune 500s have started to step into this and look at this and say, we need to pay attention to this and we need to do something about this. And many of them have already. Leadership, as it relates to the 21st century, is evolving and changing. And Deloitte said it really nice when they said this quote, "There's a critical trend out there that's happening, and it's currently shaping this new breed of leader that organizations must address in order to remain competitive in the 21st century." So this is a leading think tank on leadership. This is called Deloitte. One of the things that they're referring to in their comment has to do with gender energy balance, male energy versus female energy in leadership roles. And I think that they did a really nice job putting it out there. One of the other things that deserves further explanation is when it comes to leadership, we all know that there's core leadership competencies, right? Like strategy and innovation thinking and problem solving and team building, right? We can name so many more. What you need to understand about leadership competencies as we talk about the changing landscape of leadership for the 21st century is that leadership competencies, those aren't going away. Those aren't changing. That's the core shell. What's changing and evolving is what's inside each one of those competencies and the way that the competency is actually executed. Male energy versus female energy. That's what's changing, and that we have choices to make when we execute inside those competencies. So ROI is the second component of the business case that gets, of course, the male culture, male leadership culture out there. And the reason is because women have a lot to celebrate. We've come a long way in the last 20 to 30 years. We've got a lot of accomplishments. Let's just look at some of the accomplishments and how far we've come. There is $12 trillion to be added to the global GDP, globally, if you look at balancing the gender gap at the top, sitting in the C-suite, sitting at the board level, sitting, and I even add to it, sitting in the adjacent positions, the VP, the director positions. $12 trillion. That's not a long time to be had if organizations are really going to focus on this. Harvard research says, and puts out there that Fortune 500 companies have done over a 22-year study have showed strong correlation between having a better balance of men and women in leadership positions earns higher profitability, right to the bottom line. So we know that if you have just 30% of women sitting at the board level, sitting at the C-suite, sitting in those adjacent positions, that balance of women, that innovative thinking, that diversity of thought can impact your profitability, significantly. Pepperdine University took the best 25 firms out there for women and said that they outperformed in industry measures. 34% higher profit margin, 18% higher asset value, and 69% stockholder equity went up by 69%. These results were confirmed year over year over year. So this is not a one-time mishap. This is for real. MIT says there's little correlation between a group's collective intelligence and the IQ of the group, except when you add more women to the group, the collective intelligence actually goes up. Interesting, isn't it? Gallup, this is to debunk anybody that thinks women aren't interested in the C-suite or women aren't interested in climbing the corporate ladder, because there's only 50%, there's a balance of women sitting in middle management, 50% women, 50% men, but then as you climb the corporate ladder, getting into the C-suite, the number drops to 20%, and as you get to the board level, the numbers drop to under 20%. And then, of course, as you get to Fortune 500 companies, women sitting at the top of CEO positions are sitting at about 4 or 5%. So the statistic here shows that Gallup went out, which is a think tank out there, on women in leadership, and they said 45% of women said, yes, I want to be a CEO someday. Yes, I want to rise to a senior level position in an organization. And the other thing to realize that's so interesting that gets male CEO attention is that there's a talent shortage out there. Globally, not just in this country, but globally. And it's one of the top five things that CEOs say is part of their challenge that they have to deal with, is the talent shortage. And women are the answer to this talent shortage, because women are highly educated and they're ambitious and they want more. They've said they want more. So here's why we're talking about what we're talking about and why it matters to understand this. To get clarity on this, we need to look at what's called the playing field. Remember the women in my informal interview said the playing field was uneven for them. So for them, the playing field is really that men and women are looking through a different set of lenses when they see what the business environment is all about. And if you will let me reframe what we think we know about the business environment, and if you will let me challenge your thoughts on what we believe we already know. Let me say that one more time. The words are a little twisted. If you will let me challenge what we believe we might, that might not be broken. That's better. If you will let me challenge what we believe might not be broken about this playing field, I will tell you this, that currently females bear the burden in organizations to assimilate to this male-dominated culture. And this male-dominated culture was really set up and established back in the 1700s, the industrial era, right? And that style of leadership was command and control. Today, modern organizations, ones that are more progressive, yes, they use command and control, but they also have intertwined command and persuade. And that style of leadership is influencing and asking questions, but in a very limited way. And raise your hand if either one of those styles in today's day and age works for you. Right, I thought so. As women, that style still doesn't work for us. So that's why we say that we are, it's our burden to assimilate into their culture. And I don't say this so that we walk away thinking we're victims. That's not the message. We are not victims. But to understand once I had that clarity, it changed everything about how I interacted with men. And it increased my self-esteem, my self-confidence, and I stopped beating myself up over what did I do wrong or how did I miss that, and say it's just the way he thinks, and I'm okay with that. It's not me. And that was a game changer for me. So when we talk about the playing field, we need to talk about the twin towers of power and dominance, which is really all about masculine energy. And men and women carry this masculine energy, this twin towers. And the twin towers represents fire. When early civilization was around, the way that they cultivated civilization and they fueled the growth of civilization was through fire. And the opposite way that fire could work for them was to destroy civilization, right? It could get out of control and take down too much. So that's why Twin Towers is referenced as extreme confidence and extreme need for controlling others and the outcomes of a specific situation. These two traits that men and women carry are what maps back into power, control, and command and control. And so the reason that I share this with you is because we all carry feminine and masculine energy, and you can, I actually work with an assessment where it maps out these two tendencies on individual scales, and I can tell the individual that I'm working with exactly how, where they sit on that scale. You know, is it, how extreme is it? Are they sitting with their global peer group of CEOs or business executives? And the outcome is for male and female CEOs, on these two scales of 1 to 100, global peer group of CEOs, they actually sit at the 90th percentile. Are you shocked by that? No. That's their peer group of performers. And business executives, males and females, for these two categories, self-confidence and need for control, the self-confidence sits at 85% for business executives globally, and the need for control sits at 80. So we're still at the far end of the scale, but the needs are not, the tendencies are not so habitual for business executives as they are for CEOs. And the reason that I tell you that is because, not because these male tendencies are negative or bad, these masculine energies are bad, but because you need to understand what they look like, right? And now we can tag them with the assessment that I use. I can actually tag and say, this is how extreme your behavior is, and this is how you process things, and this is how you frame things, and this is the energy that you put into it. So now I can make a decision when I step into a performance situation as to whether or not I choose to allow myself to be my natural self at the 90th percentile, or I choose to step back from that performance situation and go down the continuum more towards some feminine energy and add a different outcome to that situation. Make sense? So when we look at this and then we talk about how does this apply specifically to women? And Sheryl Sandberg did us a really great favor when she brought this to the forefront, and she wrote a book about it, and she talked about it at TED Talk. And she talked about bossy, women being bossy and being, yep, I'm gonna say it, bitches, and being aggressive. And she said that her perception of bossiness in little girls is really nothing more than an executive skill that they're learning, right? I liked it too, but I had a little problem with it, because she commingled the words bossy, aggressive, and assertiveness. And that didn't sit well with me. The word assertiveness does not correlate to bossy to me. And it really just didn't sit well. So I, lo and behold, was lucky enough to find some research from Center for Creative Leadership, which is in the forefront of thought leaders for the last 30 years of collecting leadership data. They didn't like what Sheryl Sandberg had to say either. And they tested out their data of what leaders have to say. And they said that bossiness is not an executive competency, is not a leadership competency. And the research, additional research that proved that they were on the right track was that women who are perceived to be bossy have a 30% drop in perception in competence. Not that they actually dropped in their competence capability, but they were perceived to be 30% less effective. And guess what? It impacted their pocketbooks too. That's an old word. Their purses? That's my mother's word. Oh boy. There's a 15% differential of what they others thought they were worth. So women in leadership who were called bossy were two times more likely, I'm sorry, women in leadership were two times more likely to be called bossy than their male counterparts who were just as bossy. So There is a difference between bossy and assertiveness. And if you take nothing else away from this, take this away. You need to have assertive energy. You need to put yourself out there. What was the challenge with the first two stories that I told you? What were they lacking? Assertiveness. So it's not a bad word, it's not a bad thing, it's how you execute that behavior without being bossy and aggressive, but doing it in a way that is respectful and in a way that invites others into the situation, but you stand your ground. So as we talk about masculine and feminine energy, we need to talk about this concept of polarity. And polarity, if you think about a continuum, masculine energy at one end, feminine energy at the other. And in the middle is where these energies come together. And it's called polarity. Think about yin and yang, right? Opposites attract. The power is in the balance of the energies. Both men and women have masculine and feminine energies. I can't say that enough. Women show up with at their core being feminine, and men show up, most men, most women and most men, show up with masculinity at their core. 1 in 5 men are wired for the opposite gender. 1 in 5 women are wired for the opposite gender. So 20% of the people that you deal with have this, you know, this masculine command and control type of energy. And how they choose to use it is their choice. You know, do they use it consistently and at what cost? Or do they realize that they have it and they understand how to control it, right? Like early civilizations. Let me just read to you a few things about a Harvard Business study as they talked about masculine versus feminine energy. When they researched the difference, men said that they actually described themselves in transactional ways. And women actually described themselves in transformational ways, right? So big difference in how they use their energy. Men said that they perform their job as a series of transactions and that they exchange rewards for services rendered, that they use power that comes from their position or their authority. But women said, women use their power as a way to influence and gather data and information. And women show up in a transformational way to get others to be more inclusive and to include the whole and step outside of themselves. And women think more globally. They look at the broader goal, the bigger goal, in the way that they process. They encourage participation. They share power, and they share information. So when we talk about the differences between male and female energy, that's where we're going. Does this make sense to you guys? All right. So now we need to talk about gender intelligence. What am I doing? 10? Oh, boy. All right. So gender intelligence is understanding and appreciating the differences, the characteristic differences between men and women. And it is going beyond the biological differences that we can physically see between men and women, and it goes beyond the socio-cultural differences that are ingrained in us from the time we were children. And it's moving into understanding these the neuroscience, the study of neuroscience, and how neuroscience has recently, in the last 20 years, defined our biological differences in the way that our brain is designed. And when we have an awareness that our male and female brains are designed, and I'll show you in the next slide how our brains are designed differently, but when we have this realization and when we step into a conversation or a dialogue with someone we don't already know, we can have a better appreciation for their natural tendencies, for how they behave, how they think, and how they communicate. And that is the magic of gender intelligence, because we like to assume that your reality is my reality. And it's not true. Your reality is not my reality. The way that I see things is very different than the way that you see things. And if I have tolerance and knowledge that you are different, and I can enact my patience for you, then I can take my conversation to a higher level with you. I can refuse to shut down. I can refuse to shut my self-confidence down and my self-doubt, the stories that I'm telling myself down, and I can step into that conversation and say, it's not me, and I'm not going to take it personally, and there's a greater goal here that we need to work towards. Does that make sense when we're talking about stepping into a conversation? I actually used this. There was someone in my family who was having trouble with her new boss, who was very gregarious and outgoing and full of life, and she's, you know, right out of college working on her master's degree, and she says, he never hears me, it was the same messages. He never hears me, my opinions don't matter to him, and, you know, he talks all the time, I can never get a word in edgewise. And when I taught her the framework, she came home a couple days later, and she said to me, I understand. Her stress levels went down, literally. Her stress levels went down because she thought she was inadequate. She shouldn't be sitting in front of this executive, and that it was her. And then she just realized there was a communication problem and how she was interpreting it. So gender intelligence is all about awareness, recognizing the differences, valuing the differences, leveraging the differences, creating patience and understanding, and moving towards more balance, because what the end goal is to create a higher level of conversation, a higher level of dialogue, so that you can keep going and that you can co-create. This word down here, co-create with intention. Co-create is very different than collaborate. The word collaborate is where you come into the conversation with your own ideas and you kind of meld them together. When you co-create, you don't come in with ideas, you create ideas together because you respect the intelligence and the differences and the diversity that's in the room, and you co-create together. And when people co-create, they feel valued, they feel accepted, they feel that that they're included, right? And diversity of thought happens and innovation happens. That's the value of understanding the differences in the genders and why gender intelligence is moving us towards the 21st century leadership. Something interesting, of course I can't get this to move, am I out of time? Is that research shows us that 9 out of 10 conversations miss the mark. When we talk about 9 out of 10 conversations missing the mark, they miss the mark in connectivity with the other person. If your conversation doesn't land on me, doesn't connect with me, I don't feel valued, I don't feel included, then I go off to my own reality and I create my own reality. And that's what happens between men and women. That's where the playing field is very different. There's another statistic that says 50% of, it's an MIT research that says 50% of the performance differences out there between high performance and low performance is caused by your communication capability. 50% of success is determined by your communication capability. So this is short notes on how the brain difference appears for both men and women. There's two hemispheres, and within the two hemispheres, the left hemisphere and the right hemisphere, men have more connectivity inside, siloed inside each of the hemispheres. And women have much more connectivity, nerve endings going across the two hemispheres. And women have more white matter, 10% more white matter, which supports the connectivity of the nerve endings, than men. And men have more gray matter, which supports the left and right hemisphere. The connections inside each of the left, right, and left hemisphere. And so the significance with women having more neurological connections between the left and right brain is actually called web thinking. And this web thinking facilitates this holistic approach that women take in their behavior and the connectivity that women feel with other. with others. Women have a high need, most women have a high need to build relationships, to connect dots, despair dots and connect them, to gather as much data as possible, to be able to see the whole picture. So it's really facilitating the holistic approach that women take to problem solving and decision making. Where men come at it a little bit differently, because there's, I'm not saying that they don't connect, their two hemispheres don't connect, it's not what I'm saying. I'm saying there's less connectivity. And so their thinking and their decision making happens inside their two hemispheres, and it creates the need for them to be task focused, right? What happens, happens inside mostly the hemispheres, and they become compartmentalized in each hemisphere, and they become task focused. Remember, we talked about the two different energies. And this is where it stems from. When you think about men and women shopping, have you ever gone shopping with your significant other? Right? Can you relate to what I'm saying? Men have one goal, they need something, they walk in, they get it, and they're done. When a woman walks into a store, she may or may not have a list, but she's thinking about all the possibilities and she's connecting the dots. And she's thinking about Christmas shopping in 3 months, and she's thinking about buying a bargain. And all of those things are that holistic data gathering and relationship building, you know, where that makes men and women so different. Amazing, but different. How am I doing? All right. So I think we covered the majority of it. So let me just, this is actually my last slide, so we're probably pretty good. I want you to walk away with understanding some of these key concepts, that these are the main ways, based on our brain design, that men and women lead differently. We already talked about how we process and collect information, right? But now let's dig deeper into how we actually communicate differently. The biggest difference between men and women is their communication style. And it boils down to men and women actually have a different purpose for what communication is used for. Men view conversation as a way to establish and maintain dominance and relationships. In their relationships. Men use language to achieve tangible outcomes, and they use it as a power lean, showing their dominance. Women, on the other hand, use communication to enhance social connections and to create relationships. It's about their world of connections. The purpose of their conversation is to negotiate for closeness and to preserve intimacy. Women foster an intimate bond with the other party, often talking about topical problems and issues that they face as a community, right? There was another piece of data that I saw that talked about women who have cancer will go out and talk to 16 different people and tell them and share that knowledge. How many people do you think men talk to?
Zero.
Three. Their boss, their wife, and probably their kids. Right? So communication. We need to talk about influence and connection. So there's a few different schools of thought about the way men and women choose to influence. And one of them says that male managers are more assertive and authoritative, using that power lean to influence their subordinates, while women influence by a means of consulting, I should say, and inspiring. Different. And then the way that we make decisions is very, very different. Men tend to end the conversations once they actually connect to the idea that they're trying to problem solve for, right? Like, he found the shaver he was looking for, and he walks out of the store, we're done, right? He solved the problem, and he moves on. Singular, narrow-focused approach. Where women are inclined to be more inquisitive, they want to hear everybody's opinion, they want to be more inclusive before they make a decision. They want to collect ideas. Women are very concerned about stakeholders, right? Which maps back to relationships and how decisions impact those relationships. So a way to wrap it up is men are take charge and women come across as take care, right? Great way to capture that. We went through a lot of information, and we really skimmed across the top. You know, I like to say, closing this up by saying, For women, it's not only about being at the party, but it's also about being able to dance at the party. So I hope that in this information, you've gotten some clarity on the differences between how we lead differently, how our brain is designed differently, and the power differentials between men and women, and the uneven playing field, but not to say that we're victims. I leave you with saying, what choices do you make? What choices do you make about how you choose to perform in a performance moment? And if it's important to you, it's a performance moment. Thank you.